Wi-Fi everywhere is an industry megatrend, but it's also really hard to get right. So today we're going to find out how to crack the high density challenge with my guest, Benoit Fleury of IbWave. So join us right after this short message. So today we'll be talking about how to crack the challenge of building and designing high-density Wi-Fi networks. It's a super hot topic, of course, because in coming years, we expect that the number of connected devices pretty much inside any indoor space will likely double or triple, and all of them, of course, will need excellent high-speed Wi-Fi connectivity. My guest today is Benoit Fleury. He is VP of Product Line Management for IbWave. IbWave, perhaps the world leader right now in Wi-Fi design and planning solutions. We're going to talk to Benoit in just a second. Before that, a couple of very quick announcements. First of all, we've got two great Wi-Fi Now events in the pipeline for this fall. We'll be going to beautiful The Hague in the Netherlands actually already next week. If you can jump on a plane on Monday, you can still make it if you're in the US. And also for the first time, we'll be taking Wi-Fi Now, the Exponent Conference, to Asia, specifically to Bangkok at the end of November. So if you're interested in a role in any of our two upcoming events, don't delay, get in touch with me now at klaus@wifinowevents.com. For all the details and registrations, go to wifinowevents.com. And while you're there, make sure you check out our Wi-Fi Now news section. We've been working really, really hard on getting you all the latest news and information from across the Wi-Fi industry. So make sure you check out all the great stories, and don't forget to subscribe to that as well to get our weekly email newsletter. So that's it for my announcements today. My guest today is Benoit Fleury. Benoit is VP Product Line Management at IbWave. Benoit, welcome back to the program, and great to see you again.
Yes, likewise, boss. Good to see you again.
We're going to have to make some sort of loyalty program for IbWave on this program, because on this show, because you guys have been here a number of times. You should have like a present after you've been here or done like five shows. But it's really great to have you back. Benoit, just before we start with the get into the depth of the high density discussion, maybe just give us a 1 minute introduction to IbWave, the company, and what you do, generally speaking.
Sure, happy to do that. So IbWave provides software solutions, basically for planning and deploying any type of in-building network, whether it's a Wi-Fi network or cellular or public safety or a combination thereof. And we incorporate both the wireless aspects and the wireline aspects as well. So in essence, we provide a complete converged solution, if you will. Mm-hmm. Company's based in Montreal. It's been almost 15 years now that we've been in operation. And bit by bit, now we've pretty much become a worldwide standard for in-building network design and documentation. Mm-hmm. The software is used by over 1,000 customers now in some 90-odd countries, and including most Tier 1 operators are worldwide. And what we offer is a complete suite of solutions, so that the idea is to enable all the phases of the deployment lifecycle for the purpose of streamlining the end-to-end process. So from the very early stages of pre-sales all the way down to maintenance and operation. Mm-hmm. And last but not least, we also have a well-established training and certification program to help the users not just use the tool well, but also consistently achieve high-quality networks.
So super comprehensive. So for how long has IbWave actually been involved? You mentioned 15 years. The company is 15
Correct.
Years. For how long has IbWave been involved specifically in the Wi-Fi design solutions space?
Not the whole 15 years, but maybe halfway through that or a little bit later. Can't exactly remember which year that we've introduced Wi-Fi as part of a multi-technology offering. What we did, however, about a year and a half or 2 years ago, is that we carved out the Wi-Fi piece from the software, and we really packaged it and offered it as a Wi-Fi only solution. but that scales to a fuller solution as needed. So, more recently.
Okay, so let's talk a little bit about Wi-Fi quality specifically relating to high density, right?
Sure, yeah.
So the high density story is an important one because we see a tremendous growth in the amount of connected devices, and that growth is going to continue. And getting high density Wi-Fi quality right is actually hard, right? We know this from stadiums. I know you guys have been involved in stadium design for a long time.
Yep.
Or stadium network design for a long time. So what would you say are the critical components of getting Wi-Fi quality right in these high density environments?
Well, I love that question. We can talk about it for a long time.
Okay.
This is a great one. And one of the reasons why we can talk about it for a long time is because, as you know, there's a wide, wide range of different levels of quality. And the other question you want to ask yourself is quality for who? And I think that's kind of an important consideration here. I'm assuming in this discussion it's for the end user. So for me then, I'm going to name like a couple of obvious points and then maybe a couple more that are less obvious.
Okay.
But the obvious ones is I think you got to start with the right expectations and the right KPIs to start with. And that starts really early on in the process, is setting the right KPIs. And you want KPIs that are closely linked to the end user experience. So for example, a KPI that closely ties into data throughput is going to be more related to end user experience than one that looks at signal strength coverage, for example. Mm-hmm. Right? A lot of interference, and this will limit your data throughput, which at the end of the day is what the end users really care about. Mm-hmm. So I think that's one piece. The other one, and that it's tied to that KPI, and that's also it's pretty obvious, but I think capacity planning is really important now, especially in high density venues. I think that's quite obvious for obvious reasons. More and more enterprise right now are allowing people to bring their own devices, and there's an awful lot of mobile data that goes through the network. So I think to be able to properly plan for capacity with good granularity to in terms of zones, high capacity zones within a venue, mm-hmm. and also understanding usage patterns is a really important part of capacity planning. Mm-hmm. To me, those are two pretty obvious criteria, if you will. And then there's a few more that are maybe a little bit less obvious, if you'll allow me a couple more.
Yes, tell me.
Okay, so one is, I think it's important to consider the entire workflow of the process. And so what I mean by that is right from the pre-sales, this is, by the way, typically where the expectations are set, right, in terms of the commitments that are being made. So all the way down to installation, operations, and maintenance. And any breakdown in communication along that chain can typically lead to issues in quality. So if a survey, as a simple example, if a survey is not very well done, information is not all properly captured, well, that's going to have a pretty direct implication on the effectiveness of the next phase, which is the design phase. Mm-hmm. And subsequently after that, the installation and operations of the network. So mm-hmm. all these phases tie in. They're typically handled by different people sometimes. And so the ability to exchange information flawlessly or seamlessly between these phases and make sure that all the right communication gets communicated, then I think that in itself, in a process, is going to ensure that you're going to have a good quality at the end of the day. So maybe this one is not so obvious, but it's really, really key.
It's not so obvious, perhaps, because it's related a lot to perhaps not as so much to the actual radio tool and how the tool calculates the signal levels and so forth with the ray tracing and all that, but as much to the process, right?
Exactly. That's the point. I mean, the radio propagation is actually one important but thin slice of the overall picture. Mm-hmm. So there's a propagation, there's ensuring that the installation is properly done, the cables are run in the right places, and like I said before, the KPIs are well done, the right information is captured, understanding the type of interference that you're going to get. So all these things play into it. And the other one, which is related to all that, but it's often overlooked or an afterthought, is documentation. Mm-hmm. And documentation is really key here because typically you have a lot of stakeholders, especially when you're dealing about a large venue like a stadium. Mm-hmm. right? It's not a one-man show. There's a lot of people, a lot of different folks, sometimes even different companies are involved. So how do you ensure that the information from one phase to the other is really properly captured in a certain way and accessed in the right manner by the right individuals so that key information doesn't get lost in translation or face-to-face? And these little simple things like that that often break down and will lead to quality at the end of the day, or quality issues rather at the end of the day.
No, I think those are super good points. And as you said, I don't think the last few points are obvious to a lot of people unless they're deeply involved in the process part of their work, which is super important, right? That really has to be taken care of. Let me just ask you a little bit sort of from the helicopter's view perhaps about the trend of high density Wi-Fi. I mean, in my view, and agree with me or not, it used to be that, it probably still is to some extent, stadiums were the hardest environments, right? Because a lot of people in there, they all bring their devices, they all want to upload videos and whatnot to Facebook and so on when they're in a stadium or an arena of some sort. Now, in my view, you don't have to go too many years back to have that as a kind of a unique case for extreme high density. And a lot of other Wi-Fi was much more ad hoc, if you like. But it seems to me that now, because of the density of devices and because Wi-Fi has become so critical to enterprises, now this ad hoc Wi-Fi is really going away. So we're really looking at maybe to a lesser degree, but similar high density scenarios starting to migrate into regular, if you like, enterprise type deployments. Would you agree with that?
Yeah, definitely. Stadiums, you're right, they're an extreme case, but there's a lot of others. You'll have airports, you have other, typically public venues, sometimes large public venues that will have a lot of people. But also sometimes these high density zones might change over time, right? People might, let's say in a large office where you have a cafeteria, people will open up their phones. And so you're going to have a peak in terms of usage at certain times of the day in different places across the venue. So I think that becomes more dynamic, and you don't just see that in stadiums, but you see this in the large office space, you see this in airports and malls and so on and so forth. Mm-hmm. So
for sure,
that's absolutely the case.
Benoit, can you share with us maybe one or two cases from obviously your extensive experience at IbWave with a number of segments, with carriers, of course. I know you work with some of the big carriers in North America and elsewhere, and also perhaps from enterprises. Pick a couple you'd like to tell us about.
There's one that I can share with you. In fact, you can get more information on our website. I think we've got that published somewhere if memory serves. But it's with a system integrator in the U.S. that was tasked to kind of rework the Wi-Fi in a large convention center. So this is another case where density is important and number of usage is important. And I think that was in the Chicago area. And the goal there was to improve kind of a poor coverage that was there before. Mm-hmm. So what they've done, I think they've taken this end to end and in the case applied the IbWave tool set, from equipment that used in the field to equipment that used to collaborate between different stakeholders and this and that. And they really have redesigned the network, and they've really optimized the design, met all the KPIs. In fact, they've exceeded the KPIs that were put forth, such as data throughput, signal to interference ratio, signal strength. And they've optimized that design by actually reducing the number of APs by 30%. And so I think the design can really be optimized that way. And all of that, it took them a week to do. It took them 2.5 days to do instead of a week it would have taken them before that. And sometimes a lot of that is kind of the post-processing stuff you need to do. You go a survey and then you post-process that information or you combine this into a report or into a bill of material. So all the steps that need to happen in that complete deployment chain, the idea here is to integrate all of it, streamline it, and make sure that the information flows seamlessly throughout. And this is where sometimes you can not only save a lot of time, but you can avoid a lot of errors. and information falling through the cracks for the downstream phases, as I mentioned before. So that allowed them to do that entire thing in 2.5 days. So that was a nice success.
Interesting, right? Because you know, other people say this as well. When you actually do the design properly, you might find out that more APs is maybe not a good thing, right? Less APs in this case was better, right? Which is an interesting fact.
Yeah, in that case, yes. And it's interesting because, I mean, it can go different ways. One of the tricky things to do is to what extent can you future-proof your network? And this thing is a lot easier said than done, you know, whether it's in the Wi-Fi space or cellular or elsewhere. Because then what do you mean by future-proofing? You know, how far can you look down? So that's why I think it's important. You want to start with the tool and documentation so that you have a good baseline. So if you need to do anything at some point down the road, and you will for sure, whether it's going to be a technology upgrade or adding more APs or adding capacity, you want to make sure that you do this from a good point of reference. Mm-hmm. And so that to me is one aspect of future proofing. Mm-hmm. And the other one is also looking for, you know, worst case scenarios, mm-hmm. for example, in terms of bands. And mm-hmm. Wi-Fi, you got 2 bands, 2.5, 5 gig band. More mm-hmm. and more people are using 5 gig. Propagation is not as good at 5 gig through walls and obstacles. So mm-hmm. that's the sort of thing that you want to take into account when mm-hmm. you're future proofing your network.
So, very good answer. So, Benoit, you share with me a little bit of your experience working with, obviously you have a great number of clients that you're working with that are very close to where the action is in terms of what these carriers and enterprises expect from the coming years as far as Wi-Fi is concerned. So, what do you think and what do you hear out there in terms of the future of Wi-Fi? Do you hear people getting, you know, ramping up in terms of Wi-Fi deployments? Are they looking at AX? And I know it's still early days for AX. Are they bullish on it? What's your view on that?
Well, that's a good question because it also depends on who you asked. I mean, you'd be surprised, right? I mean, one technology or another, sometimes people have very different views of how things should be done. And we tend to not restrict ourselves to one type of technology or one type of architecture. So I think we take great pains to have a technology agnostic view of things. Mm-hmm. Now, if you ask me specifically about the future of Wi-Fi, I don't think Wi-Fi is going to go away from everything I'm hearing. If anything, it's got great momentum. So I think the future is bright, but it's maybe a bit blurry at the same time, bright and blurry. And so I think AX, stuff like that, I think these will happen because they yeah. have great attributes. But I think we're seeing a convergence becoming more and more prevalent than we've had in the past. Even though my phone supports you know, LTE and Wi-Fi, and so does everyone else's. A lot of the networks now will support both. Our tool will support both. But sometimes the people are not always the same, right? You're dealing with different groups of people, with sometimes different departments, even sometimes inside the same company, with very different ideas and philosophies. But I think that this is starting to change. And we have more and more examples now where these are being brought together. So I think hybrid type of networks, so technologies that complement themselves well. Maybe mm-hmm. in some cases compete with one another, but I think in a lot of cases they will complement each other well. Because at the end of the day, the users, certainly like me, when I'm on a Skype call, I don't really care if I'm on one technology or another. I just want to make sure that it works well. And so we tend to be focused on that. So having a converged technology agnostic and vendor and architecture agnostic solution is an important part of our value proposition, and we're maintaining that over time.
I think that's a super sophisticated view of what's going on. I have to say I share that view. I think, but I also liked your comment on this idea that the future is bright, but a little bit blurry. But this is good because, you know, the mobile industry is not as dominant as it used to be, still enormous, of course, but in many ways not really growing as much as it used to, and Wi-Fi carrying a tremendous amount of traffic. And so it's not so clear, but I do like the convergence story, I have to say, Benoit. Just Just tell us a little bit about what's next for IbWave over the, you know, the foreseeable future. What have you got in the pipeline that we should stick a pin in this case?
Okay, well, we continuously to involve across our whole portfolio for sure. So we're doing that, and right now we're very, very well established in the carrier space and its entire ecosystem pretty much worldwide, and I think that's going to continue to be the case over time. But with multiple technologies, with Wi-Fi certainly, but with a lot of other technologies as well. Over time, we're also starting to really increase our presence in enterprises, and also the same thing here. With Wi-Fi, certainly, but now increasingly with other technologies as well that a lot of enterprises are looking at the big picture and converged network. We talk a lot about, you know, Wi-Fi and wireless, but the wireline piece as for us is very important, and we support that today. So if you look at the type of designs that we do, it doesn't only include the APs, but it includes basically the entire network that makes it work behind it. It includes the cabling infrastructure, it includes the routing equipment and the fiber, and so all of this is part of what we provide, and we're going to increase that over time. So we're really taking a complete converged view of all the bits and pieces that make up a complete in-building network. And so we're doing that today, but we're going to keep moving in that direction over time, because we feel that that's what really matters. It's just not one piece or another. They have to be all integrated and designed and planned together.
Yeah, absolutely. And somebody said once, there's a lot of wires that go into building a wireless network, right?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that's right. So that's one thing. And another one that I may want to add to this is, you may have alluded to that in the beginning when I introduced IbWave, but IbWave, yes, we provide the software to plan, design, and document these networks, but we're very much a process company. If you look at how the company was founded, it was really on the notion of optimizing a process. Mm-hmm. Or building, or creating, in this case, at the beginning, indoor 2G or 3G networks. And but we really look at the process, all the stakeholders, and we understand that. So that's really what's in our DNA. Mm-hmm. And so expect over time to see more solutions that will cut across the entire workflow of the deployment process, for ways to simplify tasks and to streamline that process over time, make things.
And Benoit, it's so important what you're doing, because we all know that there's still, unfortunately, a lot of really, really terrible Wi-Fi out there. And assuring quality through making processes work properly, right, is something that I very strongly believe in, and should happen everywhere, right? So I commend you for doing that, and it's great to see you, Benoit. And by the way, I should also say you will be there. IbWave will be at our Wi-Fi Now Europe event next week.
In the Hague. We'll be there next week.
Seeing you.
Yeah, looking forward to it. It's going to be great.
Good stuff. Thank you so much for coming on the show, and please come back and see us again. All right.
Okay. Thanks, Lars.
Thanks a lot.
Very much. Bye-bye.
Bye. All right, everybody, that's it for this week's show. Thank you for watching. Thanks to Benoit for coming on, of course. And don't forget to go to our website, wifinowevents.com, for all the latest and greatest information, including these videos. We post them in there on all things Wi-Fi, of course. So that's it. See you next time, everybody, and have a great one.